and the topic looks familiar, but yet we all face it. Mental ailments, not a stigma. Stigma, we all understand, when you label somebody, when you look down upon somebody, when somebody feels that it is something that is not reputed, something that doesn't have a good image, something that we cannot carry it off well in society, it's basically what you call a stigma. So what's mental illness? How we define mental illness? Mental illness basically is nothing different from physical illness, because your mind is, your brain is a part of you, is a part of your human body. So it's a physical illness, not some disease which enters into weak minds or somebody who's characterless or something like that. We keep giving different reasons and, you know, different names to people who have mental disabilities and mental ailments. But it is also, let's just put it as a simple illness. The way we have fever, the way we undergo, the body undergoes certain changes, and the body has to, body has diseases which recovers from it. It's as simple as that. It is a sickness of mind. You're mentally sick. The way our body falls sick, the mind, the brain also falls sick. This is actually the figure. It might go up, but it unfortunately has not gone down since years. One out of every five people has some or the other mental disease, mental ailment, which either he is not aware of, or even if they are aware of, they don't do anything about it. But the fact remains that this is the statistical data. This is what we are living in, a society wherein one of every five people, me or you, could also be one of them, which we are not probably aware of.
This is from the global perspective.
It's from global India also. Even in India, this is the same ratio, this is the same statistical thing that is there. So approximately, they say that right now, even if you go on a very, very minimal basis, there are around 10% of the population which diagnosed as having mental illnesses. Undiagnosed cases to bahut hai. Now, what's common? We feel it's heart diseases which are common. You feel cancer is increasing day by day, or sugar. But unfortunately, these all are not as much as mental illness. So we give lot of importance to these things. अरे इसको sugar आ गया, sugar आता है तो घर में हम दो दिन sadness मनाते हैं. Oh my God, अब you know he or she is diagnosed as a diabetic now. अब कितने restrictions आ जाएंगे खाने पीने पे. You feel, because it's, you know, it's a silent killer. Diabetes or sugar patients, they are, you know, it's something you're carrying with you, and it can really harm you in multiple ways. Similarly, when you have cancer, you know, even if you take treatments and all, you know that there is your end, which you can see. Probably in other things, you can't really make it out. Heart disease, again, you know, ki itne ye blocked hai, arteries blocked hai, ye problems hai heart mein, bypass karna hai. Toh hum itna bada usko picture de dete hai bhi, which is, yeah, because your heart, you are alive. But we never even give a little bit of importance, even 0.% importance to what we should give compared to these. This is to something that controls our whole body, which is our brain. So mental illnesses are not given importance at all. So how does a person understand that he or she or somebody close to him has a mental problem? Something like when the person feels lost all the time, somebody who's confused all the time, somebody who's unsure. Now these are more or less, we're not saying the same thing. I mean, it means the same thing. But the person who undergoes actually suffers. For us, these are just synonyms, you know. This term used, it's the same thing. But that person within themselves are undergoing a turbulence of thoughts, turbulence of unsureties, turbulence of emotions, which he's not able to express, which he's not able to understand as to what he's basically going through. So what is mental illness in the brain? Mental illness happens when something goes wrong with the brain. Basically, that's mental illness. When your brain is not functioning the way it has to. So what could be probably the reason? So the brain could get sick because of the specific part of brain which isn't working well, a specific part of brain which is working in the wrong direction, and a brain network could be disrupted. Now, there are many reasons why this could happen. We'll go deeper into this, but these are basic things that goes wrong in your structure, in your mind, because of which all the mental illnesses take place.
So what is this? If we can have a mix of some Hindi words, that would be nice. Like you are saying, that
yeah,
would be nice. Because maybe it'll be easier for everyone also. And what is a neurochemical
messenger? Neurological thing means what basically happens in your mind. I mean, there are a lot of neurons, okay, in your mind, which are connected, interconnected to each other. So if there is in simple language, jo isme tha, tare zameen pe, the wiring. There is this basic wiring in the brain. You know, all our systems are connected in our brain. So if there is a little bit of disruption here and there, entanglement, disruption amongst those wiring, then things might go wrong. This can happen because of epilepsy attacks, kisi ko aa jate hai, some accidents which people have, or some sudden shocking events in life which can actually give rise to that chemical imbalance. So ye sari cheezon ki wajah se things happen. These are few of the reasons. Now when you see nutritional model of mental illness, hum zyadatar dekhte hai, you might have seen a lot of people roaming about on the streets, you know, half naked, without clothes. Hum aisa lagta hai ki wo utterly bahut dino se khaya piya nahi hai, aur usko dekh ke shayad aisa lagta hai ki he is probably coming from a background like that. So generally we associate, or generally we feel, that there are a lot of people, a lot of cases coming down from lower economic or very very poor economic backgrounds. The reasons could be because of poor nutrition. They don't get proper nutritional food which actually supplies the necessary essential ingredients needed for healthy mind and healthy brain. Because that is not supplied, and because naturally you have something to replace it and something to keep you working, that is the reason you need things like these people. You usually see them using a lot of tobacco, a lot of alcohol, a lot of smoke, a lot of smoking, that is cigarettes. So these substance abuses, drugs, so yes, these things increase the toxicity. So the toxicity is increased, and that is accompanied by poor nutrition, which definitely has a negative effect on the brain. So the brain and the mental functions do not function properly, which leads to various mental illnesses. So it is a process. Koi ek raat mein, you cannot find somebody turning into a schizophrenic or somebody turning into a depressed acute depression patient. Koi ek raat mein nahi hota. It's a proper process that happens. So maybe it is overlooked, or maybe it is not considered ki aisa kuch kabhi hoga, because you generally, you know, physically you're functioning quite fine. So people feel ki you're fine, hum theek hai, koi baat nahi hai, kuch nahi ho raha. Aur gussa to hume aata hai, wo to hamara nature hai, hum chilchile to ho jate hai, wo nature hai, rona aa jata hai, bas nature hai, kuch aise ho gaya, rona aa gaya. Lekin kyun ho raha hai ye sab? Now agar tum choti si baat pe, agar kisi ko rona nahi aa raha hai, tumhe rona aa raha hai, so that means there's something drastically wrong with your personality, and there is something that you are feeling very bad at an emotional level which needs to be checked out. So these are small triggers which can happen. Tab uske next day kuch nahi hoga. Over the period of time, you will find that person going and taking psychotic pills, psychotic medication, because that person was never in a fit mental condition, but it was not observed, it was not diagnosed in the earlier stages.
Ma'am, there are two possibilities. One is chemical imbalance in the brain, which could occur because it could be occurs on account of genes. So my father, for instance, my father has epilepsy, there's likelihood of me getting epilepsy.
True.
Or my father was a bipolar schizophrenic. And
True.
Second possibility is it could be substance induced. You mean addiction for a long time, and that gives rise to symptoms of psychosis like hallucination or paranoia. And it can result in chemical imbalance, resulting in mood swings and all that.
I'm just coming to that. Whether substance abuse came first or mental illness came first. Let's see that.
Okay,
I just go ahead. And as you said, yeah, genetic is the main cause, which genes definitely are one of the reasons.
There is a likelihood, but not necessary.
Yeah, it is one of the causes, one of the reasons to get into the mental illness part. But then there are many things which are definitely, the factors are in and around us, in the surrounding, which has a direct impact, which we generally oversee or you know, overlook it. Okay, did I finish that? Yeah. Psychiatric model of mental illness. As you said, the chemical imbalance which happens in the brain. Now this again, It could be genetic, one reason, yes. Second reason, chemical imbalance means when you don't eat proper food. Like, you eat what you like, you eat what you think is good. But as you know, everything that you get today is not as pure as you feel it is, you know. So maybe you're not eating in the right proportion, your body requirement is not accordingly. And maybe the burnout after which, even after you're eating all that, you know, some people have to really brain, like people who are working with detective agencies or something like that, you know, constantly their mind is at use. Not that we don't use mind, in general professions we don't use mind, aisa nahi hai. But there are some professions which involve excessive thinking, there is excessive pressure given to the brain. Now, with all these things, if there are not enough food supplements given, where you know those stresses on the brain, it gets into the relaxed position, this could be one chemical imbalance that could take place over the period of time. When you see those CEOs and all getting heart attacks and everything, the blood pressure levels go here and they're disruptive. Now, as you just read about this Bangalore CEO who passed away, who was a marathon runner, who was just 42 years old, 42 or 47, who was a marathon runner. He was amazing with his diet. He was excellent, his weight was well balanced. He did everything under the sky which a person should ideally to keep his body check. Only thing is, he wouldn't sleep. He wouldn't get enough sleep. So when he was not sleeping, now that is, this is a direct connection to your brain not getting rest. And he would flaunt with this, he would flaunt on this ability of his, on this trait of his, that I can actually pull on without sleeping for, you know, ideal hours. He would sleep for 3 or 4, maximum 4 hours. And he just ended up having a heart attack one day. So people were shocked to see a person with such a particular lifestyle, such a regular and amazing lifestyle, who was so good at everything. Everything was like well balanced in his house. There was nothing that he would even eat without noticing that, you know, this is harming my body in any way. But what happened is, he ignored something that was giving some sort of a relaxation to his mind.
So according to you, what can we attribute this insomnia to? Despite having a fantastic lifestyle, this insomnia can be attributed
stress.
To what? Stress.
Stress, because you have made yourself, you've cultivated yourself in such a manner that you keep thinking about the unfinished jobs, projects which you have taken down, you know, they're supposed to be completed. Now this personality of yours, the way you have trained yourself, you're not able to get it out of your system till you complete it. So that goes on, and maybe because some people are perfectionists, so they would also want that, you know, it should happen properly. What if it doesn't happen? So maybe that fear thing, some pessimism added to it. So these all makes up a personality of a person. So this personality personality is reflected everywhere, and mainly it is reflected in your work, because your work is your bread and butter. So when it is reflected in your work, that stress adds up. So in spite of everything, okay, this guy wouldn't sleep for work reasons, of course. But then people, as you said, people don't get sleep. Even if they are on bed at 11 o'clock, they wouldn't get sleep by 1, before 1, and they'll be up by 5. So they hardly sleep for like 4 to 5 hours, which is not sufficient. 7 hours sleep is a must. Come what may, we need 7 hours sleep. This is where our conscious mind needs to relax. We are not supposed to think as to kal utke kya pehenna hai, kya jana hai, kya karna hai. We are not supposed to think of that. Those 7 hours, we need to just relax.
Hence, there also be a hyperactive mind.
Right? Exactly. So you keep on thinking as to what's going to happen next. And they feel sleeping for those many hours is also a waste of time. They wish they could even get up at that point and, you know, do something productive.
Or it could be that the unfinished task or the deadlines to meet is an obsession.
Unfinished task. This is exactly what I'm saying. You have made maybe your work, or you yourself have made yourself in that, converted yourself into a personality wherein you cannot let go. You cannot let go of your work. You have to take it to your sleep as well. You're taking it into your bed as well.
So are you a critic of workaholic personalities?
I'm not a critic. But I feel they should work for balancing their personal and work life. So the balancing is where they need to work in. Being workaholic is definitely very productive for the person you're working for. So yeah, so this is basically could be the cause of mental illness. Parenting, a very, very important factor, could be one of the big reasons for people getting into mental problems. A child, if he is exposed to a lot of fights in the family, fights between the parents, fights between grandparents and parents, general fights, basically not a very peaceful and cordial environment in the home front. The child is exposed to those kind, lot of abuses, lot of violence. The child is bound to be a very, very different personality, a very difficult personality, I must say. My child had one such classmate who would come and keep on hitting everybody because his parents used to constantly fight and he would not get the required attention from parents. So in order to grab people's attention, he would definitely do destructive things wherein, see, for him, it didn't really matter that he is getting attention in a negative manner. It was the attention. It's something like attention. Ki haan, at least log jante hai ki mera naam kya hai. People know me. Now, actually everybody knew his name. Maybe because of the terror. But people knew his name. So for him that was very important. He of course this child went through counseling, went through all those things and now things look better. But what happens is the child doesn't know where he's going. He just needs his part of attention, his part of love. And then that small child, that small mind will try doing what he or she feels is good. So this is where, you know, he would try poking pencils into people's eyes and ears. And this was something very, very risky and dangerous. People wouldn't send their kids off to picnic and trips because this particular chap used to be there. So see, he was also feeling quite left out. You know, there were people who were not, because what could other parents do was just tell, don't mix up with this child. So later on, he did start feeling that, you know, society must say when you are like outcasted. So that kind of a feeling he started getting in his own class, that I'm not accepted by my peers, I'm not loved and liked by my people, by my classmates. So he was feeling down because of that. So but he didn't know how to really, because ghar pe bhi acceptance nahi hai, yahan bhi acceptance nahi hai. So he wasn't understanding what's going wrong. But then imagine if this child wouldn't have been counseled at the right time, what kind of a personality he would grow into. Now these are typical criminals we are, you know, which come out of such homes. Not that his parent or either of his parent is a criminal. Not that, you know, he's actually seen somebody murdering somebody. But for ek chota sa crime kiya, ek sensitivity gaya. See, the problem is sensitivity. Why criminals are born? How criminals are born? When a criminal does, whenever there is any crime happening, you see that sensitivity aspect missing. A person can brutally kill somebody, rape somebody, or do something only when the person is not sensitive towards the pain, towards the suffering of the opposite person. So sensitivity, if it's dead at that point of time, so if the child understands when he is very small that people aren't sensitive towards me, there is nothing called as emotional sensitivity, you are not supposed to give any importance to these kind of things, and there is nothing like this existing in this world, the child is going to grow into that personality.
And statistically today there are a lot of juveniles committing heinous crimes.
Exactly the point. We don't realize, see, when we use certain words in front of children, when we abuse, we don't realize that that small child is gathering, that small child is grasping
everything.
In India,
you see so many juveniles committing rape and they can get away with the fact that it's juvenile, and now the parliamentarians think we must make the law stringent, you know, that juveniles should be treated at par with adults.
Yeah, see, they feel that doing that, they, you know, see, law is just made for that. You show them, it's just rules and regulations that law can do. Rules rakh do, strictness bata do, ki ye nahin kiya, what could be the repercussion of that, what could be your consequence of that, people will get scared and will do it. But people find loopholes in law also. And there are people like, as you said, these criminals, now these juvenile criminals, when they get older, they are going to be big time criminals.
Because,
yeah, they are not bothered now. Jail ki surat tak dekh li unhone. Sab kuch to dekh liya hai. Baki kya hai unki life mein? Nahi, they are not scared. They, see, these guys, children have been royally beaten up. They have almost faced death-like situation when they were very, very much a small kid. So now what fear they have? Tum kiska dar dikha rahe ho inko? So fear is not something that's going to work for them. So what will work for them is to, again, it's a long process, it's a tedious process, but to induce sensitivity into them, which I don't know who has the patience and who will actually take up the project of doing this to all the criminals around, but this is what they need to do, because some part of their personality, some part within them is so badly murdered or ill-treated that they can't revive that. That is the reason they keep harming other people. They feel somewhere they'll get peace by doing that. So that hurt within is there, something somewhere, that wound is there, but then they don't know how to really cure that wound, so they keep on doing this to other people. Depression, one of the very, very common mental ailments, which we find almost every alternate person having it to some or the other extent. Okay, as I said, you might also have it. But if it is not disturbing my routine, I feel I'm perfect. I feel I'm just out of mental illness. But depression and the fact is, depression occurs in a human being's life at least once. So if a person claims ki main to life mein kabhi depressed nahi hua, mujhe aisa kabhi ye sab cheeze mujhe chuti tak nahi hai, it's wrong. As a person cannot pass through his lifespan without having fever once, a person cannot pass through his lifespan without being depressed at least once. So this happens. You might not have understood when was that phase. When you start reading about depression, probably you will recollect, अरे हाँ ये मेरी एक age थी जब मुझे ऐसे सब feel होता था. So that was your depression at that point of time. Luckily you came out of it, you know. You had good support system, you had good family, you had something to look forward to, so you came out of it. So it didn't show its effect the way it shows on other people. But it is a very, very common thing prevailing today.
It usually happens during identity crisis and midlife crisis, as defined by Freud and...
See, depression, basically the actual period, or maybe you can say majority of the people who get hit by depression is during their puberty. Yeah, so men and women both.
During the adolescence?
Adolescence. You know, because there are a lot of hormonal changes happening at point of time, and then it happens after your midlife. That is when typically
midlife crisis.
Yes, typically for women it is the menopausal time, and for men it is again the midlife crisis, which they typically go through.
Identity crisis, you call it during that just when they.
Yeah, it is like they don't know whether
just when they are reaching early adulthood.
Yeah, because they don't realize, people don't treat them that way, no, so they don't understand. कि यार मैं बच्चा हूँ कि आई एम एन अडल्ट. समटाइम्स टेल मी अब तुम बड़े हो गए हो ये करो, समटाइम्स टेल मी अब तुम छोटे हो ये मत करो. सो दे आर ऑल एट फॉल्ट, द वे वी ऑल्सो एड्रेस देम, इट वुड बी फॉर एनी बडी दैट यू नो दे वुड गेट इन टू दैट काइंड ऑफ क्राइसिस. नाउ वॉट डिप्रेशन, हाउ डज इट फील वेन यू आर डिप्रेस्ड? इट फील्स लाइक दैट एवरी वन इज मूविंग ऑन with their lives and you are stuck in that hole and you're not able to come out of it. This is I found this picture very interesting, because this is a typical feeling a depressed person is going to have. That person is going to feel ki I am the only one in this entire world who is in that state. They might not even know that there are crores of people suffering the same way. They might not even want to think of that, but then this is how they feel. They feel so low that they are dug in a hole somewhere. And they can just see darkness all around. They don't see any ray of hope. What came first, mental illness or substance abuse? Because usually we associate substance abuse with mental illness. But I feel, or rather, I think it's going to be proved that it is substance abuse. It's mental illness that came first.
Absolutely.
Only because people didn't know. As I said, abhi hum ye itna science advance hone ke bawajood, we are not ready to accept mental illness as any other illness or as any other normal illness. Then imagine in that era, you know, when substance abuse just started. I mean, it was there right from where our kings and emperors were there, you know. Madeira was always there. Why they needed Madeira at that point of time? To attack that pleasure point in that area, to feel good about it, to feel relieved from stress.
Psychological
To feel relieved from stress. Ki hame kuch sochna nahi hai, bas wo nashe mein, you feel, you know, being in that dreamy state. So that is the reason this all started. As in all, lifestyles started changing, these things started increasing more and more and more. मतलब जितना तुम्हारा एक इंसान प्रगति productivity की ओर बढ़ता गया, हमें the way started person started progressing more and more, the stresses and the what do you call, the burdens increased so much that the person had to take something's help, the help of something to relieve that, and then it was substance abuse. Again, it became a big productive market as well. That you know, that people they would get addicted to these things so badly that at any cost they would want these things. So that was one. This again gave rise to one major area of work, which was addiction. So all sorts of addictions then came up, and all sorts of illnesses, physical illnesses, which were given rise due to substance abuses came up. So everything started, but mental illness was something that was prevailing, and to get rid of which substance abuse, I believe, was that came into picture.
When mental illness, if you do substance abuse, it aggravates the illness.
it aggravates, but at that point of time when they are into substance abuse, they feel they are relieved by it.
That's an illusion.
Correct. But then they cannot get out of it because they have very, very severe withdrawal symptoms.
Yeah, because they lack complete insight of the illness.
Exactly the point. If you go and tell an alcoholic that aap bimar ho, isiliye aap itna daru peete ho, will he accept it?
No, on the contrary, he would say you are mad.
Correct. Now, this is just one thing that I came up. It goes with everybody. It goes with alcoholics, drug addicts, everybody. So it is said that adults who smoke are said that they're very casual smokers. No, nobody is a casual smoker. A person who smokes, 70% of the adults are more likely to have mental illness or are staying with mental illness right now. Because you see, they cannot withdraw, they cannot take away their smoking habits, they cannot take away their drinking habits. So these are the people who are mentally somewhere, they need help. Not that let's not give a name to them, but they need help. And it is nothing to feel ashamed of, it's something to feel bad for. It is something to really have pity for these kind of people. Rapes. One of the big side effects of people with mental illnesses. Only those people can do rapes. Not a person with a complete proper mental fitness will ever do that.
Is there some kind of deviation to the sexual behavior for the mentally ill to do this kind of thing?
See, there are many reasons. As I said, one could be in childhood, the person could have been molested himself. Be it a man. He would have been molested by somebody. Second, he might have seen somebody misbehaving sexually, violating some sexual laws, rules.
So, or he could be a victim of pedophilia.
That is exactly what I'm saying. He could have been molested by somebody. He could have been abused by somebody.
Has left a scar in his mind.
Exactly the point. And at times, as I said, even if they are, what I researched of lately was that in cultural places, cultural society, especially in a place like India, when men are given too much of importance.
It's a male-dominated society.
Male-dominated society. And in that, when they see now women rising up and, you know, being shoulder to shoulder on the same page, they at times cannot take being bossed by a female. And nowadays you find women at all bossy positions. They are at all executive positions. So now you imagine a person coming from a very, very narrow cultural background, you know, who's being royally treated like a king because he's a son, and then he goes working somewhere where there is a woman who is dominating him, and he has to report and he has to actually be an employee to that woman. So it's like you're giving respect, or he has to actually bow down to a second class citizen which he always thought somebody, a woman,
was. So
he has
that inferior feeling of submissiveness.
So, exactly. So just to get over that rage, that vengeance takes him over, and this is where anybody who comes across could be a victim. It could be that lady herself or some other lady, because, you know, if somebody, and you see nowadays these executive women, working women are being targeted. All good working smart women are being targeted by all these illiterates. Because they feel that ye log padhai likhai karke, they are coming up on good positions, and they keep people like us employees, and inke koi aukaat nahi hai to basically boss over or come over these positions. So that's the cultural fencing which has happened around the mind. The mind is not given that kind of
a
clue.
Like it's a glass ceiling or something. That's the word that is used.
Exactly. The thing
there's
is,
there's certain glass ceiling, you can't go
you
beyond
can't
that.
You can't go beyond that. And it is so difficult to penetrate into that, you know, to even explain things to them, that how things are supposed to be. So what happens to people who are mentally sick or mentally not fit? The society definitely outcasts them, which sometimes even we might have, you know, unknowingly. Stay away from him, yaar. Ye to bahut depressed character hai, pata nahi, aur bahut dangerous hai. Uski dimagi halat theek nahi hai. Kyunki we feel ki jiski dimagi halat theek nahi hoti, wo either violence karne lagta hai, will try harming you in some or the other way. That person wants to harm you intentionally? I don't think so. Very intentionally also, if he wants to harm you, there is more than that sadistic pleasure of putting you in that state. That person himself is not in a very, very peaceful state. So that is the reason he wants to act, do something so bad, so that you also are out of the peaceful state. Basically, all the mentally ill people, whenever they behave crazy, whenever they behave the way we are not supposed to behave, the idea behind that is that you are basically, they can't explain. Just like, here I have a wound, I can show you the wound. If I go and get my x-ray done, if I have a swelling, if I have my bone fractured, I can actually there's evidence to prove that, yeah, there is something wrong in my body. When things are not right here, I am not able to tell people what is it that I'm going through. It's a very, very suffocating stage. And by harming other people, they feel, oh, now with our pain that you are going through, something similar to what you are going through, I am going through. So this is the way they actually are making you realize their pain. But they are actually outcasted, which is a very, very unfortunate thing. So let's face mental illness. You know, what is it like facing mental illness? It's something which needs real guts. It's something that needs courage. It's very easy to stand here and say, let's face mental illness. But I cannot even imagine if one of my family members who gets into acute mental illness, how will I cope with it? Because it's very difficult to cope up with a person and stay with a person who undergoes a mental ailment or mental disease. And on top of that, you know, maintaining my societal status and maintaining that person's harmony, they are two different difficult things. So, but yet, because they are our own people, they are our own loved and near ones, we need to face that. If everybody starts discarding people like that, more and more population like this is increasing. So we are not really doing anything great by discarding these people. So if we are not able to help them, at least let's not contribute to increase such population by letting them out in open and not doing anything for them. So it's like, imagine if you got blamed for having cancer. So people tell you, or as it is, you are fighting with a deadly disease, cancer or HIV or whatever. And then if people keep blaming you, that of course HIV happening due to some reasons, people blaming you, fine, the person also knows that he's gone wrong somewhere. But HIV happening due to an infected needle, or HIV getting through due to your mother having some. So imagine that person in a way he grows up and he's being outcasted, a person who has cancer who will be told, cancer hai na, ab rao cancer mein, tumne aise kaam kiye hai, to cancer to hoga hi. See, he also knows, aise tobacco cancers, jo oral cancers hote hai, they know that they have chewed tobacco all their life and they have got that cancer. But they are going through the pain, severe pain now, after which. But then, what happens when we take care of cancer patients? Pura outlook change ho jata hai. Oh, cancer hai. Now, you know, you become so sympathetic and so understanding towards that patient. Why not for the patient who is mentally sick? We are all the more agitated, we are all the more, there's a reverse behavioral effect that shows with people who are mentally sick. So which is quite unnatural and which is quite not good to happen. So what happens in a society wherein people are not taking care of mentally sick people? So what happens, even if you know that you are depressed, there is something not normal happening with you, your thought processes are not happening normally, we all manage our mental illness. कोई बात नहीं, दो तीन दिन हम बाहर किसी से मिलेंगे नहीं, we'll be fine. So we lock ourselves in the room, we stay aloof, we stop chatting with people. So you know, we think by doing all those things, we are getting rid of our mental sickness. We are actually repairing our mental ailment, which is not the truth.
It is counterproductive.
Exactly. So rather don't learn to be with it, cure it.
You should never sulk.
But this is because of the societal fear and the taboos. People do that, right? So people need to stop the stigma of mental illness so that more and more people will come out saying that, yes, I do have a problem, I do have an issue. I was just watching this this serial on MTV, Yaariyan, because my teenage daughter watches it, so I was watching it. I mean, it was at a very odd hour, 7 o'clock something in the evening. I was just sitting and they have taken up two good issues. I think the reason that this particular serial is made just to focus or make people aware of two issues and not criticize those two issues is, one is homosexuality, because which people feel that, you know, even they are outcasted big time, and second is people with mental ailment. So this is where, you know, they are showing it very openly. The one of the girls who is like completely in her teens and college, and she says that I will go to the rehab center and I'm taking up drugs and started taking my medication and treatment for my depression. So, you know, it's something that is very outrightly accepted and spoken, and which again shows that, you know, how friends treat her when she is a depressed person and when they realize that she's taking antidepressants. And then she comes up saying that, oh, I've again started because I had to start, but don't worry, now I have taken the charge, I've taken the responsibility that I will come over it. So I'm going to the rehab center and now I will be out of it. So this is what people need to understand. We need to at least tell people that it's fine. You know, only one sentence from others and it's okay. Aisa hota hai. It's just so much okay. The person will find himself in a much confident position to go and take some treatment, to do something about it, which he was not taking care of. So at least that much I think we can do, rather than stigmatizing. So, you know, this is typically the feeling a person gets when he or she is undergoing that mental ailment. If it could be seen on the sufferer, nobody in the society would have said that just get over it, because it's that bad. It's somebody killing you from within and which people cannot see. Can you imagine how bad would be the feeling? I mean, just put yourselves into that position for a minute or 5 minutes and think that you are somebody within you, within your body, only you know is killing you, and the whole world feels that you are a crackpot. It's such a bad feeling, such a bad feeling. So again, what happens? You, a person with all the wounds, emotional, psychological wounds, the mental wounds, change him as a person. आज इंसान ऐसे ही चेंज नहीं होता है. यू से ना कि नहीं, इसके साथ लाइफ में बहुत बुरा हो चुका है इसीलिए आज वो ऐसा है. वो बुरा हो चुका है, वो उसका उसकी वजह से वो एक ट्रांसफॉर्म पर्सनैलिटी है. उसको क्योंकि पता नहीं था कि वो जो बुरा हुआ है हाउ टू कोप अप विद इट, तो नेचुरली ही वॉज अ चेंज पर्सन. सो डोंट, वी आर ऑल ऑफ अस फॉर दैट मैटर, ईच इंडिविजुअल, ईच ह्यूमन बींग इज बॉर्न एक्सट्रीमली नाइस, एक्सट्रीमली प्योर. नो बडी एज अ सोल विल बी एवर बॉर्न विद अ नेगेटिव ट्रेट, to kill somebody, to harm somebody, to get jealous of somebody, nobody. Because all souls basically are very happy souls. We all born as very happy souls. But because of so many introductions and so much of exposure to negative things in the society that we live in and the environmental factors that we are exposed to, we have the personality that we have. So rather than making yourself that particular negative personality and giving blame to the environment, might as well take up the charge of bringing about that change from within and taking proper treatment and guidance so that you get into a happy self, which you are supposed to be, which you are born with. So this is a gloomy feeling which people with mental ailment always feel. You know, kai baar aisa lagta hai, you know, people, especially people coming from very rich and so good backgrounds, when you see them suffering, the first question comes up is, sab kuch to hai, bas isko hi problem hai. Kyu problem hai? You never understand that ki kyu problem hai. You always feel ki what we see is the outer facilities that the person has. Itna paisa hai, itni gaadiyan hai, pati bahut acha hai ya patni bahut achi hai, itni achi family hai, bacche bacche acche hai, in-laws bahut acche hai, sab kuch acha hai. Everything is good, ki business acha chal raha hai, he's making lot of money, career itna acha hai, fame hai. So what is bothering this person, that this person, do you know, you've not peeped inside that person. There might be thousands of unsaid stories that this person is carrying with him. There might be so many episodes, events in his life, and out of which you don't know which event, which episode has actually turned him or actually affected him at that mental level, which has made him like this today. So there are so many things that these poor people go through within themselves. So you really can't tell how much suffering is there on a face that's always smiling. So when we see people who are very jovial, all the time smiling, but each one of us, as I said, each one of us, because sometime in life, if each one of us have had fever, then sometime in life, each one of us has necessarily gone through that sad, that negative mental phase in life as well. But because we were able to get out of it without any problems, We feel that हम तो कितने normal थे, हमने तो एकदम normal से अपनी ज़िंदगी निकाली है. Why can't he do that? You were a stronger personality, तो तुमने उसको cope up कर लिया. तुम्हारी background अच्छी थी, तो they managed you. He doesn't have those factors. You know the person who's suffering right now. So he or she is actually tagged with a mental illness. So now someone you know who has a mental health problem, अगर हमें लगता है तो you feel अगर खराब लगेगा, so you start with yourself. See, this is my way. I always do that. Because when I sit on the counselor's position and when people come to me, they feel कि यार इसके लिए बोलना बहुत easy है. कि ऐसा होता है, वैसा होता है, ये ऐसे कर लो, ये वैसे कर लो. उसको क्या पता what is going wrong with me? All the people who come and sit on the opposite chair is definitely going to feel that, and I can very well empathize with that. So I start like that because I need to know what their problem is and to make them comfortable in the first place that it's fine, you can come out, you can come up with your problem, just speak up. You have to make them realize that it's such a normal thing. It is such a normal thing that these things happen. ये होता है, सबको होता है. एंड देन व्हेन यू टेल देम कि पांच में से हर एक इंसान डिप्रेशन का शिकार है या पांच में से एक इंसान मेंटल इलनेस का शिकार है, शायद मैं भी कभी रह चुका होगा, वन स्टेटमेंट फ्रॉम योर एंड कि मैं भी कभी ऐसा रह चुका होगा, मुझे पता नहीं है, आई माइट हैव गॉन थ्रू इट, द पर्सन फील्स हाफ मोर कॉन्फिडेंट टू ओपन अप देयर प्रॉब्लम्स इन फ्रंट ऑफ यू. आपके सामने आपके से आपसे बात करके शायद उसे सोल्यूशन ना मिले, बट इवन इफ द प्रॉब्लम सेट is half solved because you're venting out, you're actually getting that feeling which was just within you getting out to somebody else, so you're relieved to that extent. And then when the person is relieved, you can tell that person, why don't we seek professional help, it's really fine. लेकिन जब वो बहुत ही डिप्रेस्ड है, बहुत ही सैड है, तुम उसकी बात नहीं कर रहे हो, सुन नहीं रहे हो, उसको बोलो अरे तुम जाओ साइकेट्रिस्ट के पास जाओ, यू गो टू अ काउंसिलर, that person is going to feel like banging your head ki ye kya hai, you think I'm mad or what? See, this is what happens, right? Most of the time when you tell a person, why don't you see a counselor, why don't you see a psychiatrist, the counter question is, you think I'm mad? That is what people say, you think I'm mad? But when you empathize with them, when you stand at a bossing position and when you point out at people, they feel low, you're making feel them low. You got to make them feel at par, equal. It is then when something that you want can get into your heads. So this is how you start a conversation, that it's fine. Mental health is not really a stigma. You can open up. So these basic things, you know, just panic, anxiety, which we see a lot nowadays. You know, all the children are very anxious and everybody, every parent is very anxious. Aur ye do mark nahi aaye. Do you ever remember our parents saying that? दो माँ कहाँ गए, our parents never said that. So now in everything you find these things happening so much, तो अब हर किसी का नाम दे दिया गया है. So now these anxious parents, it's very nice to know that these anxious parents, they also are very 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 aware of psychological health of the children. So they don't scold them, they don't scold them, they don't hit them. No, it has a very adverse psychological effect. But they have an extramarital affair. They don't give them time, that's fine. बच्चे से बड़े तहजीब से बात करते हैं, बच्चे से इतने अच्छे से बात करते हैं, अब्यूज नहीं करते हैं, बट दे डोंट हैव कॉर्डियल रिलेशंस विद देयर फैमिली, विद देयर हस्बैंड. द चिल्ड्रन नो दैट देयर इज समथिंग हैपनिंग, देयर इज समथिंग फिशी कुकिंग इन माय फैमिली, दैट्स फाइन. सो व्हेन यू आर अवेयर दैट योर चाइल्ड अंडरस्टैंड्स द वे यू टॉक टू द चाइल्ड, देन व्हाई डोंट यू अंडरस्टैंड दैट योर चाइल्ड ऑल्सो अंडरस्टैंड्स यू नॉट गिविंग हिम दैट लव अफेक्शन और दैट कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन विच यू आर सपोज टू इन द फैमिली. So these things, even if it's there, there is a cure, there is a hope. So people can get out of it. My purpose is, people do get out of things only if you wish to. That's very important. So now stop the mental illness stigma so that the treatment can start. Now treatment not necessarily always means that taking in pills. As you said, only if it's a neurological problem. If there is a problem in the chemical imbalance or the wiring, then probably at times you need to take in the pills, the psychotic pills or drugs. Otherwise, at an initial level, if you understand that there is something happening with you and just started to happening, you were never like that, and something very abnormal feeling that you started getting, then that can be easily solved by mere counseling. So if you do not want to go to that stage, please get aware of things fast. Make others aware of it fast. At times, talking to a stranger helps rather than talking to a family member. Because when you talk to a family member, you have this impression in mind that this person is biased. Like for example, if you're talking to your father, you know your father has particular principles. That is his nature. So even if he's trying to comfort you, you feel that no, this is his nature, that's why he's saying this. Same thing for your good. If a counselor is telling you, it'll be easier for you to buy that. So it's just a human way of looking at things, that we feel it's our family members say something because you know them so well in and out, you feel that it is some of their biased personalities that's coming and telling you this. And because they don't want you to do certain things, they are telling you this. So you know, you start and taking that in the wrong way. Rather, it's no issue going and seeking professional help.
One more thing is that with parents, you can't confide certain things, but you can confide in a counselor, because a counselor is non-judgmental and non-critical. So they have a lot of comfort zone. They share a rapport and a comfort zone with a counselor. So confide in a counselor.
True.
And can't confide with parents.
Exactly. And parents, see, they are again, because they are parents, they are very emotional. Like tomorrow if you come and tell them that you have committed certain mistakes in life. Now parents, more than forgiving you or explaining you that what could be the consequences of that mistake, or how can you not repeat that mistake in life, that worry, anxiety takes over them so badly that they either start bashing you uprightly, that how can you do this, how could my child do this. So first of all, they feel that failure in their parenting, ki mera bachcha aisa karke aaya, which is not acceptable. Secondly, wo worry aa jata hai dimag mein, because wo emotion involved hai, ki oh my god, my child has done this, now what will be my child's future? Usne itna bada galti ho gaya hai, ab wo kya karega, uska future kaisa hoga? But when you are telling this thing, to emotion jahan aata hai beech mein, wahan pe generally wo behavior up and down ho jata hai. Matlab wo parents, they are maybe very intelligent people, they understand everything, but when it comes to their own child, naturally there is lot of love and emotion involved there. So with that, there is a lot of worry involved. So because of that worry and emotion, they will never be able to give you the right kind of judgment, as you said, without being judgmental. And children, because they know them too well, they feel that certain things coming out of parents is because of some hidden issue they have. That is, even some motive that they are saying that. But a counselor, you can just tell them, and again, with a feeling that this person is dealing with such things on day in day out basis, so the person is more expert into dealing and giving advices regarding these things. So that's again an advantage. So it's important to spread mental health awareness. It's very important that we gentle citizens should do that. I get really affected when I see medical professional people not doing it. But I believe they themselves have so much to take into consideration, because their own field is full of stress and chaos, that they cannot really sit and counsel a patient. Because say, for example, if you say an orthopedic doctor, agar wo patient ko counsel karega, to who will look after the leg or the hand that is broken? So naturally they have lots of things on their in their day planned, and which they have to do as a expert in that area. So they cannot necessarily, which ideally they can, but they cannot, they don't have time to do that. But if we general citizens can actually start taking up that into our responsibility, then why not do it? Whoever you feel is suffering, genuinely suffering, why not just tell them or start spreading the awareness ki ye sab hota hai, just get yourself cured. Abhi initial level hai, get yourself cured, kuch nahi hoga. You will find yourself in a much better position. Go and just meet somebody. What is the importance of creating mental health awareness? First is, this is because it affects all of us. As I said, it's more or less, it's affected all of us. Secondly, it's a great burden on every country. Not only we ourselves, jaise hum sochte hain ki hamari family bach gayi hai, usse family bacha ke, we are not staying in a forest, right? Hum jungle pe nahi rehte, we are staying in a society. If you are not affected, you are staying with a person, a neighbor, you are friends with somebody who is probably affected, so now that person can harm you or themselves. So why be so selfish as to just be look into your family? Try looking at people around and try telling them, at least spread the awareness at a very, very normal level, that it's just fine. Secondly, mental illnesses are top 4 in 10 disabling conditions of the world. Whatever is going wrong in the world, even riots for that matter, riots, the main cause, the people, the minds behind these riots are all mentally sick.
Now they are brainwashed.
They are sick. Even the main mind, the supreme mind of behind this riot is also sick. That's because, as you said, they have a boundary to their thinking beyond which they wouldn't go. They have this particular ego which will prevail them in accepting broader outlook and new ideas, and this is where the entire thing starts.
And for that matter, terrorists are also indoctrinated with the hate ideology, and that's how they become terrorists.
Exactly. And see, they pick up, now they pick up people at their adolescence again.
And at the tender age where the mind is susceptible to
what is, that is wherein they put in the wrong ideas. Right? That is wherein they put in the things wherein you develop that negative feelings for people around.
And that's conditioning at a young age.
Correct. And then they expose them, as I said, then they expose them to conditions wherein their sensitivity is lost. Like, you can imagine those people, I mean, the Taj Mahal attack, people just brutally killed and they were not affected by it. I mean, just 10 of them. 10 of them could do so much to a country. And they could survive on dry fruits for these many days. So the way they were completely trained was amazing. But what for? I mean, was it giving any productivity to us, to them? Nobody. So this is where, I don't know what kind of a good feeling that those sad minds were getting. But this has ultimately done a very, very bad, it is actually not spreading a good message around. So this is what it is. Seek help, visit a mental health practitioner. Very, very important. We have very few mental health practitioners, which is again a very sad thing. I had visited one small town in between, and wherein I learned that there are no counselors there, apparently. There are just psychiatrists. So I was like, that's a very sad thing again, that, you know, even with a little bit of depression, you need to go to a psychiatrist. You know, a psychiatrist is not to be blamed. With his profession, he will immediately give you antidepressants. Even if it is 0.25 mg, your body is actually taking in that medication that you're not required to. So I don't say medications are bad. If it's required, if it's a question of life and death, you've got to take it. That's a life savior. But if you can really get over a situation without putting in all those medicines, why not do that in the first place? Why not just get aware of it? So this is where you can just seek help, a professional help. Because there is no health without mental health. Thank you.
That's true.